Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. Yes, I'm doing the same joke again that I did with Dallin Jr. I'm wearing the mask. I've got a different one though this time, but you can't see my mouth. So am I saying these words? Am I dubbing them? Who knows? I am joined this week by the high-flying, death-defying Lucha DS. Welcome to the show, sir.
Hello, thanks for having me.
So I thought I'd make you feel at home. By the way. Yeah, I thought I'd make you feel at home by having one myself. This is a, I think this is a mystical one. I'm not sure. I think I called myself El Sperma Blanco when I initially got it, which just means the white sperm. Right, so we'll go for the boring question, as we always do, and then we'll just spin off from there and speak about dinosaurs. How did you get into pro wrestling?
I think I've kind of talked this story to death a bit, like through my own podcast and stuff. I went to a show, always loved wrestling, went to a show, and it was Green Oak Town Hall, MC Tommy, Scottish wrestling legend, was in a ring, and he announced that there was a school opening up in my hometown. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to be there. So I went along day one and joined the class. And where we now, maybe 6-7 years now. And I still wear a mask. So
I had to... Just revealed myself there, just because I don't want to distract anyone by my non-mouth face. MC Tommy MC Tommy's to thank for your career. Is that what I'm getting?
Yeah, every time I have a match, I thank MC Tommy for my career. I think most people in Scottish wrestling thank MC Tommy for their career.
They thank MC Tommy for many things, I'm sure. So how did the mask come about then? What was your why? Well, why did you get the mask?
The initial thinking behind the mask was Mary kind of keep a bit of kind of autonomy in doing wrestling. I don't talk much about kind of my day job, but I've kind of in a day job it's particularly important to have a kind of anonymous online presence, so you kind of be kind of traced and looked up. Basically, I work with offenders and. Being able to not be able to get found online with your real name or photographs in local areas and stuff, just so you can't be tracked in by somebody with a wee grievance. It's a kind of protection thing. That's why on Facebook and social media, before I'd done wrestling, I never used my name. I always use my old high school nickname. Just that way, just a kind of layer of protection when using social media.
All right.
So that was the kind of idea, and I said, well, if I'm going to do a show, I don't really want my face to be on a poster in a town or a city where I might have worked with a couple of individuals who I don't particularly want me to know where I'm going to be on the Friday or the Saturday night.
was there still inspiration though? I mean, because I'm going to get to your mask designs further on. I have noted down here, but. Was any particular luchadors or mask wrestlers that caught your eye, that were your inspirations kicking off before you started?
Like it's always going to be Rey Mysterio. At a time when wrestling was at its height, like WWE was in its height, Rey Mysterio was the mask wrestler. And to this day, people still associate him. Like even people who weren't the fans of wrestling back then will see a mask wrestler and say, look, it's Rey Mysterio. The name is just, it's like when you look up things on the internet, you say, oh, I Google it, you use that brand, whereas Rey Mysterio is now just the word, I think, for mass wrestler. I don't think people particularly know, like a younger generation know what Rey Mysterio done or how big he was or the fact that he was a champion and stuff. They just say masked Rey Mysterio. And I think that's just a kind of association. So he was a kind of main one. I wasn't one of these ones that kind of delved in and followed the history of the mass and stuff, because I feel a lot of it's the kind of same repetitive old stories. Like obviously the traditional Mexican stuff is great, and like they would wear their masks all the time, and like it gave that kind of superhero vibe to it, that they didn't know their identities and stuff. And then saying that, Rey Mysterio had done the whole stunt when he wrestled with the mask as well. So it was merely the tie-in with the mask was more obviously the line of work I'd done, and also the style fitted what I could do physically. I do gymnastics, I'm quite flippy. So they kind of meshed. It was a good mesh together to do that style with the mask.
So would you say you do gymnastics and flip stuff? Was that something that you did growing up?
I've always done it. I've done parkour, gymnastics, done a bit of dance at one point as well. I've just always been physical. I've always done physical stuff along with all your other stuff where you do play football like a couple of times a week, play 5s, 7s, 11s. Always been active, but gymnastics, trampolining, flipping, street running and stuff was always something I was right into. It was a kind of passion. So being able to kind of use that in the ring was always going to be a bonus, especially when we went to training the first couple of times and you seem like, not to play bash anybody, right? But when you're in that kind of main intake group, you're looking around and you're going, nobody can really do anything. Like, they can do the moves and the techniques that they're being taught, but maybe they could just bang that wee bit extra. And my thing was always like, yeah, I could do this, or I could flip into it. And it was, so I'd done it to amuse myself as well.
I suppose as well, if you're doing things like dance and parkour, your timing must be pretty in tune, and that must be something that, because, I mean, wrestling is basic art form is just a dance, and
well, it's a performance, isn't it? And yeah. The whole thing with all them different like forms of movement and motion, it's all body control, and that in professional wrestling is body control. I like to think if I jump off the top rope and I say I'm going to land on this, like if you put a coin in the ring, I'll tell you I'm going to land on it, and I know 100% I can land on it if I'm in control of what I'm doing. So it gives you that confidence to be able to move your body in a way that protects you, but also lets you get from A to B. And then you just add a bit of flair or a bit of style to whatever you're doing.
Yeah, exactly. I was dancing around, for lack of a better term. So who would you credit to being the people that trained you initially? A lot of people, I know you were trained down. It was Airdrie or the Barhead school?
No, that was the two original schools. So that's when the Greenock school opened. So the Greenock school opened, the PBW Greenock school opened, I would like to put a year on it, but to best my knowledge, I would be guessing 2013, no, November 13. It opened 2 weeks before my boy was born. Excuse me. And when I went down, it was Scott Maverick. Real name is Gary Burns. He's now a tattoo artist. You can follow him on Instagram and stuff. I'll plug him. So he trained me, and I became really good friends with him. And he had just had a wee girl over time. I had my wee boy. My wife and his wife became pals. We went to each other's weddings. And then as the training went on, it was time for me to make my debut. And he suggested that he has his retirement match against me in my debut match. And a show in Mabel. And that's what we've done. So he signed off by, kind of, I'd like to think, kind of handed me the reins of, there you go, pal, like, on you go, this is what you've learned to do. And I loved that match, it was so much fun. And Gary, Scott Maverick, was a fun guy, so big credit to him. Obviously, there was loads of other people involved in it. In training, you've got Kid Wright, who ran PBW. You had, in Greenock, it went through a phase where what we would do was, you would train at Greenock, and then you would get to a certain stage where they thought, like, oh, you might be able to go on and do something here. So then you would move up to Barhead, and I was kind of tamed as kind of being, you would go to the big school. Greenock initially had loads of young folk in it, so I needed to go to Barhead a wee bit more to kind of train with, like, fully grown adults, like guys like the size of Donny G, Sakiba Lee, who else was there at the time when I was doing it? The guy who was Switch, who else was a kind of adult? Wasn't it? Kenny Williams is one of them as well. Aaron Echo, Krieger, like they were all kind of coming along there more often. So getting up there and getting in and doing matches with these guys who were just maybe a year ahead of me was more beneficial to my learning than staying at graduate school and training with Maverick. So it was kind of just like going from primary school to high school. You just you were learning the subjects, but you were just learning a wee bit more.
I'm so kind of rounding off what you've already learned, and we're just getting a bit more intricacies and things like that. I'm going really far ahead. We'll stick with your first match then. So it was against Scott Maverick in his last match. Did you find that the mask helped you create the superhero persona as character in front of Craig? Because I mean, masks, kids love masks. It's just a fact.
I always tell people that there was always this kind of thing as like you get booked because you wear a mask, and I'm like, yes, absolutely, 100%. It adds to the kind of reason why you stand out a wee bit more from this crowd of the current 20 new trainees. There's a mask guy, we'll have him. Absolutely, it works in your favour. And then on the flip side of it, it's completely disadvantageous in the fact that I've got no peripheral vision when I wear it. I can during the match, I can't hear if anybody tells me anything. It's like having a cooker wrapped in your head for the whole time you're in the match, whereas everybody else can breathe and get a breeze and stuff. I'm literally suffocating. Like the mask you had on earlier when you opened the show. Had your mouth covered. I'd done that for one match and I thought I was going to pass out about 5 minutes in. I wore a bandana there. I was working heel and I thought I need to look me like a bad guy, so I'll cover the mouth with a bandana. And bandana was off. Couldn't breathe. And so the fact that I can't see, I can't hear, I can't breathe, it's the sticky end of the stick, as I say, of being the mass wrestler.
Well, at least you've got that parkour background that you or in gymnastics, so you kind of know what your body control is, even though half of your senses have disappeared.
and that is why I'm able to do what I'm able to do, is because I'm basically going, I'm going to do a back. It's like saying I'm going to do a backflip, but I'm going to do it blindfolded. I need to trust that my body's going to do what I need that I've trained it to do. Because like Ray likes a wrestling look, King Sharp. Don't know how many times I've wrestled him, but every single match either ends with my mask turned so I can't see, or it ends up pulled up here because he pulls on it like it's my hair. He tears it. He's just a nightmare to wrestle with a mask, because he treats the mask as, I don't know, I think it offends him. So as well as wrestling me, he's wrestling my mask as well. There's also loads of fun to have with it as well. We've done spots in match where I've put a mask on him and stuff. So, again, it's another tool that you can use to add an extra element to a match, as well as just doing a flip.
I do have a note that I've just written down, it's one of my notes here, looking sharp. Because I think you both have said online that you guys could probably wrestle each other in your sleep, that you wrestled that many times and probably had the same match that many times as well in places.
I would say I've wrestled them that many times, and I think if you watched all our matches or you had like a compilation of them all, you would struggle to find a kind of dot to dot exact same match. It got to a point where we would do a bit that we knew worked in one match and another match and a bit worked from another match, and then it became this kind of compilation of kind of the hits. We'd done all the bits we knew worked, and then the last two or three we had were amazing. And it got to a point where we've done it that often, we've done it that many times, we trust each other, as we would then start to have fun with it. So in the middle of the match, winding each other up, like getting them in the corner instead of like not calling a spot, like you're winding them up, slagging them off. Like it then becomes like you then have fun with it. I mean, that's what wrestling's meant to be. And it's meant to be fun. It's not meant to be like, oh, I'm going to get an day A, B, and C. I'm going to get and see how I get from A to Z and have a laugh on the way.
So it's one of those things you got to kind of feel the crowd as well. I'm assuming you kind of have to go with them. If for whatever reason you go out there and then they decide that, not that they're not giving you a reaction, but they're vehemently disliking you, then that changes the whole dynamic. I mean, again, you've got the mask, so it's very unlikely that you're going to get boos unless you're trying to get boos. But I suppose there's that off chance that you can go out there and looking sharp is the big fan favourite, and everything changes in an instant because of that. So you had your first match there with Scott Maverick. We've covered that quite well. Am I right in thinking that were you quite quickly off to the camps from that point, or was it just working in and around PBW?
So that initial match was January. Camps kind of came in, don't know, June, July. So yeah, I was on the camps that first year. My first match on the camps, as far as I remember, was me and Lewis Gervin against Sakiba Lee and Looking Sharp, I think it might have been. Might have been. I've got like a sheet where it's got all my matches. I need to look up like for that specific one, but I know my first match on the camps, I teamed with Lewis Gervin, and it was against Sakib. I just remember that. I don't know who his partner was. I think it was Lou.
But and did you find that was, I mean, you, at that point you would have been wrestling not even 6 months of that, well, around about that 6 months mark, so you might not have seen a or felt a difference, but did you find that wrestling in front of non-wrestling fans to be a bit of a different animal, a bit more like getting thrown at the deep end?
It's actually more fun, because you're not having to pop the kind of smart marks, whatever you want to call them. Wrestling fans are amazing, best fans ever, because they love the product, they love what they're given. If they go to a show and it's rubbish, they're online, they'll tell you it was rubbish. If they go to a show and they love it, somebody stands out, like they can blow somebody up. On the other end of it, they can go to a show and they go, like for what you said earlier, oh, Lucha versus Looking Sharp. That's the fifth time I've seen this match. Well, it's because you go to every show, mate. You're gonna see all these. Like, if you just stay in your run routine, you'll see that match maybe twice in 3 years. But if you go from that show to that show to that show, that promotion, sorry to tell you, mate, you're going to see similar matches because the guys have all wrestled each other a few times, and the world of wrestling doesn't have a Premier League 20 people squad for each promotion. And there's only so many guys that you can work on shows. Only so many good guys can work so many bad guys as well. So getting on the camps was brilliant, because having that 10-minute match and instantly having to make it 20, you go, oh, that's where you learn. Like, make this move 10 times more. Make it bigger. Let these people who do not know this product take in what they're seeing, rather than hitting somebody with 10 moves. The person in the crowd just sees, oh, I see it happen. You're like, they're not getting it. Whereas if you go to a kind of indie show, you'd be like, oh, this move, that move, that move, that move. Somebody like can put that kind of chain together. Non-wrestling fans, you've got to slow it down. You've got to make it bigger. It's more about the performance and the character. So it draws it out you. So that was the kind of difference with the camps, if that makes sense.
Yeah, pretty much they're paying to see a show. They're not caring what the show is particularly, but they're just coming to see a show. So you've got to make it like as far as you can into panto territory. Because, I mean, the biggest match of all time was Big Daddy versus Giant Haystacks. And could you tell me 5 moves that was done in the match? Didn't need to. It was the performance. Exactly. It was two big guys running into each other for a bit. One falls over. Match is over. That's it.
And they got the fans to believe. They wanted this guy to beat that guy. It didn't matter what it happened with. It didn't involve, I'll tell you what they never done in it. There was absolutely no Canadian Destroyers that match. There was no super kick combo. But they told the story with the tools they had. And that's all wrestlers can do. then is that kind of work to your strengths, hide your weaknesses, and in between it with the guy and the ref as well, who's obviously well involved, you create, for that 15 minutes you're in that ring, you're creating your piece of art.
So as far as the, as again, I seem to be concentrating on the mask so much. Am I right in thinking that you did majority of your mask designs, or all of them? Was that you designed them and then sent them off?
So the initial mask design, I was looking at different types of masks. I didn't want the Rey Mysterio, but I knew I wanted the mouth open because I wanted to be able to breathe, wanted to be able to speak. I'd done a seminar with a very prominent mask wrestler, who told me, because initially I was going to keep my eyes covered, like with the mesh, and he said that breaks the connection with the crowd. Don't cover your eyes. Like the fans need to be able to see the pain. You can only show so much pain with your body, with your face. My face is but maybe 80% covered, so why cover the last bits that communicate with the crowd? So, and the design, the mesh got deleted. I was very conscious. I didn't want anything dangling or hanging, because when you're doing a flip, if I'm throwing myself, I didn't want anything hooking or twisting or grabbing onto something that was going to hinder me. So I wanted it very streamlined. Then from this bit to here, with the kind of head, the middle of the headpiece, that was a Punisher design that I kind of drew. I'd copied the skull. And then the bits down from here was mailed fangs that I wanted, rather than have them come out. And then that way, I made everything very angular as well, because I wanted it to focus. So that's why the nose has got the triangle, and it always stands out across for the SD mask, because I wanted fans to just not be looking, there's a mask, like there's a shape. I want them to be looking at something. So I want them to look at the eyes and the mouth, so I have them focus here. It's an art design, from when I've done art, that you want a focal point for to get attention. So no matter what the head's doing, when the head comes around and looks, people always look. They maybe don't realise the look, but they look, and it draws them into what I'm trying to show them.
As soon as you said that everything was angular, I didn't actually click, and then I just went, yeah, everything's pointed to the centre of your face, so yeah, everything's going to your eyes.
That's an arrow, and these are pointing to. So it's got four arrows pointing right where I want you, right where the money is. So yeah. That's the reason for the design. I also, I knew I wanted to do a kind of Scottish thing, like I thought it also looked kind of Salt Irish. Mm-hmm. When I've got the blue and white on, it looks a bit like a Scotland flag. So I kind of had that in mind as well.
Is that the majority of your time outside of wrestling now, or actual your work is just thinking of new ideas, new designs, and because I noticed you, remember you got a Spider-Man inspired one that looks amazing.
Spider-Man one's purely because Spider-Man's my wee boy's favourite superhero. In fact, I'm sitting in his room right now, and there must be about four or five Spider-Mans, and I can see just now in his room. So Spider-Man was always going to be one that I was done. The Scotland team one was one that I was always going to get done with all the flags. The tartan one as well, Scotland team. And then I was going to have like, all the multicoloured camouflage. And there's only so many colours of camouflage you can do. So then it kind of changed to whatever different logos, spider webs, and so they'll get two Spider-Man. I think I've got like maybe 14 masks just now. Then I got the Star Wars set, the Boba Fett set, just because I like Star Wars as well, and Boba Fett's the coolest character, so I thought I'll get a mask like that. So that's the only mask I've got. It covers my mouth, because I can really do the design.
It's for appearances only, not for actual wrestling then, if it's covering the mouth. Just
no, no, I've wrestled in it three or four times. It's a nightmare. And one of them as well, I was talking to my opponent backstage before we went out, and he offered me a bit of chewing gum. And I was like, cool. So I popped it in, I'm talking away, and then he was like, oh, music hits, and I forget I've got it in. So mask comes down, so I kind of spit it out. So I'm like, oh, I've got a spit of chewing gum. And I think I was up on the top rope, and he came up and punched me. And as he punched me, he punched the chewing gum out of my mouth. So the chewing gum's now stuck inside my mask, at my mouth. I kind of get it out, so I think I got him in the closet, throw him out of the ring. So he threw me at the ring, and I think the ref came and checked me because he thought I was hot. He thought it was an injury, and literally I was just trying to scrape a bit of tune down from the inside of my mask because I couldn't breathe. So yeah, it's like that. See the Incredibles, no capes, mine's just no mouth covers. And every time I cover my mouth, it never goes well. So that's why the design is so prominently open. That it also means that's why I keep my wee beard, because people always ask me when I'm not got a son, why have you got that wee, people call it a landing strip, why have you got that in your face? And I've said because it goes in my, it stands out for the mask, and it's also
again it points up. Yeah,
so it's another arrow.
Nice. Yeah, I've got, well, the other mask you may have seen, the Talon Junior one, that's the one with the open mouth one, but it's got hair at the top of it. I don't know, because all heat goes out your head. I've got no hair as it is, but all the heat goes up the way. It's just a pressure cooker in my head when I wore it. I respect anyone who decides to cover their head for something that involves strenuous activity and sweating. I get hot thinking about it just because it feels so warm.
That's also the kind of downside. See with the camps as well. So normally in your match with the camps, like instantly as soon as the match goes 1, 2, 3, the seal will roll out the ring and go backstage, and the fun star on it instantly go, anybody like a picture of a Lucha, just make a queue here, and you can be there for 25 minutes to half an hour. Your match is already longer because it's on the camp, so you're doing 20 odd minutes, so you're literally at maybe an hour. And people, anybody's got a photo of me after a camp show, like that smile is stuck on, because underneath there I'm snotters and sweat, and it's disgusting. See, when I go back and take that mask off, and like the smell, and it's atrocious. And that whole time I'm standing a lot, and all these photos of all these kids and adults are enjoying their holiday.
You're just going back and just wringing it out just straight afterwards.
Oh, it's minging.
Again, I mean, we're still in the mask. You've got Lucha Scotland, which was the faction, was it not last year, was the year before, 2018 that came about?
Yeah.
So it was with Robbie Solar, Soldato, and Falcon. Just the 4 years, not three Soldatos. And how I think you did speak about it in your joint podcast on the Tuck of the Draw, which I listened to at the time. Unfortunately, I don't remember a lot of it, which would have been handy when I was doing note taking. But how did Lucha Scotland come about? It was just, you guys have got masks, let's do something.
It was purely a branding idea. If you think about it, you had Falcon, who was Reckless Intent, Solar, who was at Source, Soldato at GPWA, Wrestling Speed in Scotland, and me at PBW. And I thought, like, it was always the kind of old days of Scottish wrestling. That company's mask guy, that company has a mask guy, that company's a mask guy. I said we should all be working together because we're just stopping each other from having more opportunities. See if we come together, doesn't matter what one we're on. You can have two people on at that promotion. You can have two people on that promotion. We all promote each other, so it's not just Source of promoting Solar. It's not just PBW promoting Lucha DS. Like, anytime I put up a match, you share mine, I'll share yours. And as soon as we start showing that solidarity, you'll see kind of the needle being moved. And then instantly, I think within the first week, Solar and Falcon were booked for a tag team tournament. Myself and Soldato went down to Southside in England. Me and Soldato done Wrestling Speed in Scotland, me and Solar became the tag team champions at the Scottish Wrestling Alliance. We went up, me and Solar done United Pro Wrestling. Like, they just, as soon as we'd done it, everybody, it was as if somebody had went, why has nobody else ever done that idea and put the mask guys together? Because not only if you booked me on your show, did you have my following promoting it, you have three other guys who aren't even on the show going to promote it. So it's more eyes, you've got more customers. It's the way I put it across to anybody is like, it's an opportunity for us to get more eyes on your flyer and your poster, and as well as that means we get to hang out with each other. If we're doing something where we're teaming together, it gives us an opportunity to create something new, and then big massive wrestling come in, and they said, I want to book all four guys. I was like, yes. This is what we've wanted the promotion to grab all four of these. And they said, yeah, I want all four of these to fight each other. And at first, I thought we'd all been like, oh, no. But I was like, perfect. And it gave us a chance to do a crazy match. And it was crazy. And it's one of my favourite matches I've ever had. So Lucha Scotland was basically gave us an extra wee nudge, get more eyes on all four of us. And the four A's were all kind of friendly anyway. Like we didn't cross paths because we weren't always on the same shows as each other. So it gave us another wee kind of, I don't know, like a wee external bubble that the four of us could go off and create something and then bring it back to our promotions. And it only benefited everybody. And there was no downside to it. And then when we did all get together and do that podcast with Stephen, that was one of my favourite days. In fact, we were all drinking before it. I was steaming during it. And then after it, we had a night in Glasgow. And that night, it was one of my best nights that I've had. So it made everything more fun. And then before Corona, Scottish Wrestling Alliance asked us to use the name. We were going to do Lucha Scotland shows. The shows were going to be called Lucha Scotland. And I still believe that that is planned. Another promotion did ask us to do it. And we were going to do a Lucha-only show for another promotion. And they kind of put the brakes on it a wee bit. SWA came in, snapped it up. So, like, and I'm assuming I would have been on that show. So it was creating, it was generating work for us. So to me, it's a win-win.
I remember SWA did say that they've got something coming soon or something new coming soon. So that's what it was.
The shows were just about to get announced before Corona. There was a bunch of shows that were all going to come.
I think one was supposed to be Inverness, because I remember that was when they had to postpone initially the Inverness incoming one at the start of the year. It was saying, oh, we'll be back, but with something new. So I'm assuming one was going to be up at my end here, up in Inverness.
Because I think up in Inverness we did do a, I think it was me and Solar, but then me, Kieran, Jack Morris, I think we had done a match where, and I think initially I'd have been good if all four days were wearing masks, or we should have got them, the guys who didn't wear masks to wear masks that match, just for the match.
Mm.
Because that's one of my favourite things to do, as soon as when I get your show and like somebody's like, oh, what will we do for this match, blah, 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 and I'm like, put a mask on. That's how I done the one with Grado. Me and Grado, when we teamed, Grado wore a mask. Who did it? I tried to get Jack Chester to wear a mask. On another show, me and Jack were meant to be in a tag team. And then on the night of they never announced the matches for the show. The match was meant to be me and Jack Chester as a team. And then on the night they changed it, and I did black mask and all. I'm looking forward to doing that one. That one didn't work. Then I done the one with Liam Thompson where I fought Liam, and Liam wore a mask. He wore a Spider-Man mask. Green Uptown Hall. Brown. So just again, it just gives you another dynamic to have some fun.
Yeah, pretty much. It gives you a whole extra world to, because the mask can work if the heel is wearing it ironically, or if your tag team partner's wearing it to be solidarity as a team. It's a perfect way. Let's be very much with Senzo Volto. So that was United Pro Wrestling. So it was a well held match. Senza a French? Am I right in thinking that? Is it a French match wrestler? So what was it like?
I nearly said his real name there. I think his real name's it. He was on WWE, wasn't he? He'd done a tryout. He'd done a tryout for his mask on, they named him and stuff. But I'll not date here. So I done a match up there with him. That was a good laugh.
So I think one of their biggest shows. Was it the Rocks Hotel? Was that the match, or was that?
No, they done it. We done that match. We main evented this match in Mintlaw. But I think it was one of the busiest shows. The one at the Rocks Hotel was me and Soha versus Yuji Maki and I should really remember his name. He was a promoter.
It was probably Stallion then, wasn't it?
Stallion, Martin Stallion. I cannot remember his name. I went blank.
Yeah, so they were a team up in UPW. I remember it anyway. I thought there would be more to it, to be honest. Was it just an international name, or was it just a case of you guys both have a very similar style, you know what you're doing, just
I think initially I wasn't meant to have a match. I think he was just booked to come and do the show because he was kind of doing a tour of the UK at the time. And when the guys who ran it told me that he was on the show, I just said to him, I want the match. And they kind of hummed and hawed about it because I think they had another idea for me that night. And I was just like, nope. And I never asked a promoter. I never asked for a match. I never asked for an import. I never asked to be on a certain spot. I just do whatever they ask me to do because that's my job. My job isn't to book a show or promote a show. With talent they've got on it. And I said to him, no, I want this match. They came back to me fairly quick and said, yeah, do you know what, that's a great idea, let's have that match. And the match was really good. The guy, the French guy under the sense of auto mask, was interesting to plan with. His English is good, my Scottish isn't great, like you got to balance out. And so he's the only person who have planned a match. Now, this, I don't think I've ever told this story. We planned it with Whistling. So right. It was, so rather than going, I'll put you in here, they'll send you off and da da da, it was all literally standing going, shh, 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 and we planned the whole match through Whistles. Huh. And it's the most bizarre thing I've ever done. And I was kind of having fun with it backstage on the day of the show. I think I was talking to Johnny Pugs. And I said, this guy's whistling at me rather than calling a match. Well, using whistles. And I kind of had a wee giggle about it. And then not only did I really like the way he'd done it, I then found myself doing it at other shows. So I'd be like, see that bit? I'll... And it's daft that I kind of adopted it because it makes sense. Well, a lot of times you get hung up with guys like newer guys or trainees, like they'll call a move or they'll say, I'll hit you with this, and I'm going, what is that? I don't know any names of moves. Like you need to show me, you need to show me the movement. I need to know where I need to be. So yeah, I'll whistle, I'll go, oh, and that bit here, I'll go in, and they go, aye aye aye. So it was a thing I adopted from him. Really nice guy.
Every match is a learning experience, isn't it? Speaking of that, you were in the first GPWA Asylum Invitational.
That's right, yeah.
I've written down here. I've reminded you about it. So what was it like getting chosen for that? Was it just Red Lightning just going, or were you put forward for it? What was the staff?
I believe how it worked was they had their group of guys, and I think it was just given to Kid Fight as, you give us 4 euros. I think at the time it was Whippy at Source gave us 4 euros. I think they used 8 of theirs, and I think what the understanding was is like they would use us to promote, like help build their guys up, and turn, we'd obviously get a rub for their new eyes on crowd, friends and family, kind of growing their product as well. And then I think every year it was going to rotate. I don't know if it was like PBW are going to host it one time, but it kind of, after the first one, it just all changed. And it then became the Drew McIntyre Invitational. And I know it was meant to happen last year. Or did it not happen last year? I know it's one of the things, like I kind of knew it was going to happen. And then when the plans changed, and I go, did that happen? Because I wasn't involved in it. Like I knew other young guys were getting another shot at it. And they were going to go kind of younger this year. Or last year, but it kind of fell apart.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It was 17 was yourself, and then next year was I can't remember who won it off the top of my head. Irvin Garrett, I think it was. And then the 19 one got cancelled, and then obviously the world.
Because my year was Aaron Echo, wasn't it?
It was. Yeah, he won the first year. It was Irvin Garrett was second because he beat Damien, I think, in the final.
Because the second year was a good, I'm saying that was a good one, because they'd done the wild card.
Yeah,
they had just the three schools, they'd had WrestleZone.
And they had Reckless, and Theodorus was the Reckless guy for the wild card.
And he's a good guy as well. So just for what I was saying earlier with the Lucha Scotland thing, just look at these different dynamic matches when we don't just close off and say, this is us and that's yours. So I think Damien, did he not kill it that whole weekend? Like, I wasn't even there, and I heard about it, like, how well he done in that tournament.
Yeah, and I mean,
if they'd have kept it the same format, he wouldn't have been part of it.
Yeah, for me, up at this end, of course, I was keeping tabs on all of it, because I have to for this site, but I was keeping tabs on Damien's matches, because he's from my way, from Northeast, so
right.
I was always keeping an eye on his, and he was apparently just smart. Well, he got to the final, so obviously he was doing something well, smashing through the weekend. So,
and I'll let you in on something as well, like kind of a peek behind the curtain with that. He got to the final because he was doing so well. Then the format didn't change. It wasn't all penciled in that this person's going to go bum 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 all the way to the final. They were looking to see who was performing and how the crowd were engaging. So he was there on merit.
All right. So yeah. So yeah. They had their first round maybe. First round, they knew Hugh was kind of going through this next bit, and then that was it. From there, it was just an absolute open playing field.
And on the night, I know there was changes made on the night due to how people were performing.
That's a fascinating way to do it, because yeah, that just leaves it. I mean, Scottish wrestling, there's no bets being taken or anything like that, but that's a fascinating way to book the show and just keep it all open playing field, and you're not just sitting back going, right, that's all the matches done, I'm going to go out and have a smoke while this is all taking place. That's fantastic.
But then if you think about it the other way, it's also very clever, because say there's 8 matches, it means all 16 people competing know that they have to perform. You kind of go out and phone it in. You go out and phone it in, you're out. Well, I'm saying I went out the first night, so that's my fault.
So you've been well travelled. Just concentrating on Scotland for a second, you've wrestled pretty much all over, including up in Caithness, and you became the CPW heavyweight champion not long before they closed. I don't think that was coincidental at all. But
oh no, I was totally my fault. I killed it.
you killed Caithness, bro. Wrestling.
I killed that.
So what was like travelling? I mean, I know Dean Ford sent a question and asking you for the best road trip stories. I bet there was a fair few things happening between travelling from Greenock to Wick.
And for the record, Caithness isn't closed. It's just called something else now. It's called Combat League Wrestling.
Yeah, and you're one of the houses. You're in one of the houses, I think, aren't you?
I'm the house leader for Team Raven. Let's do it. And the idea of the new format is amazing. And it's that whole thing about I just said. It gives you a different dynamic to go out and perform. We were talking about points on the board. For your house and your team. I think we were in second place after the first night, but a really good format. But that drive up to Caithness, and that's what Dean's fishing for, because some of the best car journeys is having Dean the car going up and down there. But it's that drive is a killer. Like, obviously you're from Inverness, so you know that. See just that drive from Glasgow to Inverness, that one road with the new runabouts and no gear change, like you're driving, it's like hypnotising. Like, it's so long, it's so boring. So you need a good car. You need fun people to win with you. You don't want people going to sit in the back and go for a nap and just expect to turn up 6.5 hours up the road. So Dean's a good guy being a car with. Who else is really fun? Angel Hayes is really fun for that drive as well. And Logan Smith. I think I was a last car as well as Solar, because the way it normally works is it wasn't really like separate, but basically due to shows being done here the night before, I would have to drive on the day, because I'd be doing here doing like I think it was Pro Wrestling Innovation I was doing the night before the last couple of dates, the way it worked out. So the PBW guys tended to travel up separate. Or the Pro Wrestling Innovation guys would travel up separate because we were on a different show. And the Source guys, their show was usually like the day after our Fierce Females would be on. that weekend, so they would be off the night before, so they'd head up. And that drive is brutal, absolutely brutal. It doesn't matter what time you leave at, it's just monotonous and slow. Then you get to Inverness, pilot to Inverness, usually into Burger King where the cinemas, grab some scran, pop into Tesco's, use the bathroom, get a couple of drinks in, hydrate, back on the road for that final bit, which is the nice bit of the drive, that kind of scenic coastal road. By the car journeys in wrestling are, they're interesting, they're always fun. At first, it used to be told, like, don't just sit there, like, ask questions, you're in there with your peers and your veterans and, like, pick their brains. But 9 times out of 10, the guys are, this is a 500 trip, they don't want to hear you break down an international. Like, they just want to chat normal stuff, they want to, you know, videos, films you've watched. So, wrestling chat fizzles out fairly quick, unless somebody's getting interesting, like, by night before. Did you hear about this or hear about that? And it turns into a kind of gossip session.
I know from my experience, I did a bit of driving for Rock and Wrestle, and I had Joey Legend and in the car for Aberdeen to Inverness, and I'd stop in between because I live in Elgin, so it's just about halfway between. I had to pick up my girlfriend, my wife, because she was coming to the show. So I had this car with myself, Crusher Crabe, Joey Legend, my girlfriend, and I can honestly say that not one in that last hour and a half of driving, wrestling was not talked about in the slightest. It was all about shows and Disney and all that kind of stuff. So I suppose, I mean, at the same time, like you're saying, nobody wants to sit for 500 miles really going on about this wrist lock, this is the intricate details of our wrist lock. They want to chill before they actually have to go to get a single wrestling.
Sometimes, like, obviously you're involved in a wrestling website, so like you're inundated with all this wrestling. See, with me, I'll be completely honest, since lockdown, I haven't watched a bit because I just can't watch a show with any fans. I know you've been on the Thunderdome wall of Spotlight when you shared it. I can't take myself to watching it because the whole point of wrestling in a ring is to perform for the fans who are there and then react from how they're reacting and how you react in the ring. And it would be the same if I was asked to go and do a show, closed doors. I'd be kind of lost. I'd just be going through emotions. I'd just be like, right, this bit will do this, and I'll do this, and I'll do this. But without getting that feedback, that instant feedback, you wouldn't know if it's going well. I find myself, I'm a bit lost with it. COVID has grounded it a halt. I always try and find the positives. And the positives, I haven't wrestled since March. My body is the fittest it's ever been. I've got knee injuries. None is sore. Whereas before, like, it'd basically be what is sore today, whether it be my foot, my ankle, my shoulder, my ribs. There was always an injury because you're just physical contact all the time. And since then, I feel fitter than I've ever been. So I take that as a positive.
Absolutely, I think so. It's definitely allowed a lot of wrestlers to kind of just heal. I mean, right now, obviously nothing's happening. I mean, there's some places that are open. I mean, when this goes out, it'll be January, so we might have a bit of a clearer idea at that point what's happening. But honestly, I can't see any wrestling shows happening until autumn next year, safely anyway. Maybe some behind closed door stuff.
I think you're not far off the mark. I'm open to taking bookings, but I will not do a booking where I feel there's any hint at all. I think people not been looked after as much as we all want to get in the ring and perform with fans. The fans need to be protected as well. That's just a theme across Scottish wrestling. Just the fans need to be protected, and putting people at risk. Like, even me, the first thing I do when I come out is high-five every single kid in the place. I'm like, bah, 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 bah. Within the first minute and a half, I've touched maybe 120 people. Like, just by doing that first look. And then the first thing I do is going to grab my opponent. So if somebody in that wee da-da-da-da-da-da-da has something I don't want, I'm getting it. And I'm going to get it to them and get it to the next one.
So yeah, the referee's there, so the referee's going to pass it on to the next guy, and it's just...
Exactly, and we're sweating over that canvas, so... until it can be done safely, nobody should be putting shows on. But I'll tell you one thing: the very first day they say shows can happen, I'll be up. I'll be first in the ring. I'll be knocking the door of every promoter who is ready to do it when it's good to go, and I'll be fighting to get. I want to be the first wrestler through the curtain at the first show.
That'll be the time that you've had four matches in it, but that'll be definitely the one that the Boba Fett one comes out, just to be on the safe side.
My new coronavirus mask. That's what my goal is. My goal is for the first show that I'm on after coronavirus, I want to be the first person through the curtain, which technically I shouldn't be. It's usually bad guys at first, but that night I'm good at first.
I think that's the time the exception can happen, especially if it's the first show back. You don't want to be the first reaction when the show starts is to boo. No, you want the big cheer and wrestling's back. That's the thing.
And but, I know what it's going to be. It's going to be me versus Looking Sharp.
Of course.
I'm going to come out first and he's going to come in the ring and he's going to cough all over me because he's a wee scumbag. And the whole match is going to be him coughing me and me squirting with hand sanitizer. I've already got a match planned.
Yep, I'm all in for it. You mentioned that you won the SWA Tag Team Championships with Solar. Was that your first championship? Am I right in thinking that? Was that your first, other than maybe a hardcore championship somewhere? Was that your first actual belt?
I think so. That's bad. I should really know. I think it was the first belt. It was me and Solar versus Polo Promotions. Motherwell Concert Hall.
A big team to beat for a title, especially with Mark Coffey now as NXT UK and Jackie Polo.
Mark Coffey, I think I've not watched much NXT UK stuff. Like I said, I've not been following it because once it stopped for me, I kind of lost interest in kind of following it the weekly episodic or whatever it's called, but I think Mark Coffey is he's a kind of dark horse in it. Like, he's been using tag team in three-way and that, but I think see if he wants to take the reins off him and let him go solo, I think he's the main guy, I think.
I don't think he's ever had the opportunity to really show his charisma outside of Polo Promotion, so I think they've kind of kept him similar.
Mark himself, outside of Mark Coffey Kappa is hilarious. He's a really good guy, really nice guy as well. So, I think if WWE or NXT UK, whatever moniker they're using up him, like, give him a real push, he's a star in the making, I think.
Absolutely. I mean, you're saying about watching wrestling. I think this lockdown has made me watch more wrestling than ever before, just because I'm working from home, so I could watch the pay-per-views on a Sunday, and then I could just my bedroom's literally on the other side of this wall, so I could just come in and look like utter crap because I don't have to look at people.
I'm still been watching old stuff. I'm just not watching any new fans. I'm still watching my kind of old favourites. I've got the High Spots Network, which is great. They've always got loads of content up, and it's always kind of new stuff. But the best thing is they've got a big vault, a back catalogue, a kind of old, obscure brands as well. Just because a certain name was on it at a certain time, this kind of back catalogues went on. So there's loads of stuff out to watch.
Alright, so it's just to keep, that's. I see both sides of it. For me, I've enjoyed it, but just because I've been able to try and appear on this Thunderdome thing, which is still the weirdest thing ever. But it's getting me to actually watch the show. So clearly,
is it true? They're feeding you today, but
they tell you right. This is what they did at the start for it. My very first one, which is one of the first Thunderdome ones, did Kevin Owens do the introduction, and then after that, they stopped doing that entirely. But they've got a guy telling you, what do you think of Sasha Banks? What do you think of... And then you're supposed to read their mind and you're supposed to cheer or boo the baby face or the heel.
Right, okay.
That's what they tell you. And then I got booted out of a stream because they went, what do you think of Sasha Banks? And that was after she attacked Bayley. And I booed because I don't like Sasha Banks particularly. I think she's really great in the ring. I just don't like her character particularly. I think she's just so smarmy and so cocky. So I booed her, and then suddenly I got kicked out of the Thunderdome. So
because I got told that like basically they were feeding people like at this point we need everybody to do a thumbs up.
Yeah,
we need people to cheer. Or...
So I don't know if I was the only one who got booted out, because the next one I got into, it was very very clear cut what you had to do, which was. Thumbs up for so-and-so, or boo Roman Reigns.
But how are they telling you to do that? Are they doing it as the show goes on, or are they telling you this bit, we need that, this bit?
Yeah, the audio comes over. So I was watching it on the laptop. You see the live feed, which is about a minute, which is actually live. The network's about a minute behind, and they just come over the audio and just go, thumbs up for
dance
so-and-so.
Dance monkeys, dance!
Pretty much. And if you don't dance, you get booted out. So you're just like... Yeah,
that's mind control stuff. But that proves my point of that you're not getting a reaction. You're not getting a natural reaction. Mm. Because sometimes I've done shows where wee guy in the front row is like, you're a dafty. You're just like, what? Look at you, look at the state of you and your mask, and you're like, wow, man, like that's worse than any boo, that one wee voice. But it's an honest reaction. He's trying to get a reaction from me. And then in turn, any time of day in the match, I'm looking for him. Like, can you do this? No, you can't, you'll be dafty. But it's that reaction. And I read online. I don't even know, was it you that posted it? But somebody posted, like, basically when you're on it, you're told, thumb up, cheer, boo, blah, blah, blah. And I'm just like, I love the scene. I think it looks great, but let people react. I know there's a few people took the mic maybe and held stuff up and all that.
But... Yeah, there was someone who had a certain better not to go into it. But yeah, some people have taken advantage of it. I think that's possibly why they've just went from what do you think of so and so to do what I'm telling you to do.
Who is it that's talking? Is it somebody you know? No.
Just a voice. It's not Kevin Dunn or anything like that. It's just a voice just telling
you. It'd be cool if it was Vince, but...
I would love that. I would... You know, everyone has rightful bad things to say about Vince, but I guarantee you, if he came over that audio and told you to do something, you would do it.
You'd do it.
Yeah.
The guy's a lunatic.
I know.
I mean, you don't live to that age, being the shape he's in, run that size company and being normal. Like, the fact that people come out and go, did you hear what so-and-so done? You go, yeah, he's a lunatic.
Well, he did the Gronk jump at WrestleMania and in the rehearsal because Gronk wouldn't do it. Or Gronk was exactly. Like, I'm not sure. And Vince just went, right, that's what you do. And just jumped off himself. Yeah, he's just nuts.
Yeah, that's what bonkers billionaires do. They jump off stuff. That's how they become bonkers billionaires. They don't become it by sitting behind a desk and like putting numbers into a computer. You've got to be a special type, and he's that special type.
I think it was a story that came out this week as of recording that it was some sort of idea got shot down, but it started with Vince going, we're going to do something in this hospital and we're going to destroy this hospital. I should probably buy this hospital wing. And then the idea got eventually shot down and he just went, what was that idea about buying a wing? I should probably still do that. And then he just wrote down the word hospital and then walked off. It's like, he's insane. he's the guy you want to interview, but at the same time, you just sit there going, I have no idea what to ask you.
The thing is he would completely razzle-dazzle you. He would mesmerise you. He'd be the most normal guy ever if you sat and talked to him. He's not going to sit and pull his hair out. You know what I mean? In front of you, like when it's time to turn on, it turns on. But then you get a wee glimpse of him being a lunatic when he wants to be a feather of Stephanie's baby and stuff like that. That's a special kind of character.
Before you know it, you'd be standing over there over a bin being puke 2.0 and he's just shouting at you.
Boogeyman spitting worms in your face or something. Like it's the weird world of professional wrestling, as I say.
Speaking of the weird world, There we go. You've been keeping yourself busy during lockdown. I'm noticing with your at the start anyway, doing the things like your Taskmaster challenges with your son. Was this just all just stuff just to keep you active, keep you motivated, just keep
try
you sane?
Trying to keep a wee man busy. he was off school. I love Taskmaster, so I was doing the challenges, and then I'd just done a YouTube channel for my boy, so we just started making videos for him, getting content for him. So we kind of versed into that, and my boy's a mad gamer, so just now we're crushing Fortnite, and try to get all these Marvel skins unlocked. So the idea initially, because at first, like when you guys were doing like your tag tournament and your elimination tournament, it was good for people who are wanting to create content. Like they don't want people to be forgetting that there's a wrestling scene out here. But same way, wrestling scene, acting scene, comedy scene, it's all dead. Entertainment has fizzled out. Even though they forget that 9 times out of 10, this is what people spend their money on when they earn money. And TV shows aren't getting made, films aren't getting made. Yet, during lockdown, everybody's cramming Netflix and trying to get as much content as they can. So I was like, I need to do something to be creative. I jumped on a couple of your tournaments. I think it was a tag tournament, a singles tournament or something. And then it got to a point when you were doing all stuff, and I was kind of like, you know what? I can't join in because I would be lying if I'd say that I'm enjoying that. I've got a point where, obviously, the whole speaking out movement and everything with wrestling has slowed everything down, and everything's ground to a halt. And what promotions are still promotions and not promotions, and like,
it sucked the enjoyment out of it. It just stopped you.
And then it got to a point where, like, if you said you were a wrestler, like you instantly became associated by proxy, let's say. And then but people tend to forget, like, well, earlier on you mentioned Crusher and Damien from up north. I've never met them. I've wrestled all his time. I've never been on a show with them. There is a wrestling scene, there's a wrestling world, a wrestling bubble, but the guys in it, like, I have not physically seen another wrestler since lockdown, because I don't go in that social side, social circles. The guys who go to gymnastics tell, like Craig Anthony, Soldato, and Solar, who have come along to gymnastics class. But when it comes to actual wrestling training schools, I've been away, because obviously coronavirus lockdown and bubbles and all that. So when all this has happened, I think everybody kind of now feels isolated, that we're all. I guarantee you there'll be guys who aren't going to come back, who will surprise you that they're not going to come back because they fell out of love with it. There'll be other guys who were on the periphery or maybe getting into shows and coming on to do stuff who are going to come back and be stars because there's gaps opening up. And we kind of found that with the NXT UK thing when a couple of guys all got whipped off of shows because they weren't allowed to work the indies and stuff. So wrestling, when it comes back, I think will be a different animal altogether. I don't want to get into depths of the speaking out thing because I don't know. People very quick to come out and condemn and come out and give their sides of the stories and all that. I don't have stories, and I never witnessed stuff that we spoke about. So me coming out and putting my name on it or showing support or not showing support, it would be false. It'd be a false narrative to give. The way I explained it to one of my pals when he was asking me about it, I said, like, if you work in Tesco's, like, you work in Tesco's in Inverness, and I work in Tesco's in Greenock. We're both Tesco's workers. I don't know who you are. And what you do in Inverness has no impact on what it does with me. But then if a story comes out that Tesco workers are all bad people, then we get tarred with the same brush, whether it be up there or down there. But there's a disassociation because the stories and the stuff that was coming out, and it's not, and I'm not saying I don't believe stories for a second, but what I'm saying is I have no emotional attachment to it because I'm not involved. So that was one of the reasons why my podcast stopped back in March as well, and that was before speaking it stopped, because I'd nothing to promote. I wasn't saying come to this show, come to that show, or I'm watching this wrestling or that wrestling, because I was kind of like, oh, well, let's just have a wee break for it. But when wrestling does come back, the podcast will be back, and it'll be more interviews and speaking to people, and I'm sure there's a lot more stories to come from people who do feel involved and feel that it's had an impact on them. So,
absolutely. The speaking out movement in general is it changed the landscape. I mean, this was, if there was any time for it to happen, it had to be during a prolonged break in wrestling, because then there's enough time for things to reset, enough time for things to change, or at least put plans in place. I mean, we're not going to know if these plans work until the shows come back, or if they come back at all.
Yeah.
But at least you can see the workings of companies going, right, this is what we plan to do. Whether it works or not, we don't know, but we're going to find out. But you're absolutely right. There's going to be people that you'll be surprised that won't come back for whatever reason. We'll never know why.
I'll find it. Because I'll have them on my podcast and I'll ask them, why not wrestling or not?
As long as you don't play on Friday, I don't need to undercut my work here.
I'll tag you in a post. But no, it's the whole thing with wrestling, and I always say it, the day I stop enjoying physically doing it, or the will be the day I stop doing it. The day I started, it was never a plan to get to WWE. And it was always said to me in training, if you don't want to be non-training, that seminar where another Scottish promoter who said to everybody, put your hand up here if you want to go to WWE. And then a couple of people, and I did not put my hand up because I'm older and I know what I can do and what I can't do, and I know what they're looking for, and it ain't a 5'6" wee Scottish luchador. Any time they sign a luchador, the first thing they do is whip a mask off them. Because they only have one luchador in the same Rey Mysterio, or else you're part of the Lucha House Party when you come out with your pinata. So I know what my market is. And I said, no, I don't want to go to WWE. And it wasn't me being like, oh, I want to go to Ring of Honor. Like, I wasn't being a snob about it. I know what I want to do and what I don't want to do in the day. I stop enjoying it, it'll be a day. The mask comes off and it stays off. So there'll be other guys who have lost, fell out of love with it. There'll be guys who just haven't done any sort of physical training and will be in atrocious shape and will need to get back into shape to get back into it. And some of them might not want to do it anymore. And then there'll be other guys who don't want to share locker rooms with other guys who are there. And that's the other side of it. Like, the first time a show poster goes up with certain names on it, you know it's going to happen. Twitter's going to be like, whoop. And then it's going to be up to the guys who are in the locker room to decide whether they want to be on that show as well. So there's a million and one moving pieces that are going to be thingy, and my whole thing is, let me go first, then I can get in my car and get home.
Sally, avoid any trouble, I'm going home.
Let me do a couple of flips, sell a couple of posters and get down the road, and time to get a wee Chinese before I go to my bed.
But no, I'm exactly in agreement with you about the losing enjoyment of it, and then that's over, because when that all started coming out, right, and the amount of stuff I had to take off the site, just either as a precaution or they were clearly named out and things like that.
I done it myself. I messaged you.
I messaged you
on the page and I said, can you take something off? It was a piece I wrote myself.
So you did it yourself as well. But yeah, I took down about 800 posts in total. And it was just, by the time I finished that, I thought, right, okay, that's that done. Another story came out, so I had to go back on and delete more. And it was just, there was some names that, if they got named in something, I think would have just killed everything for me. I would have just went, nah, that's it, that's me done. But that's why I've ended up doing this podcast, because people are, guys like yourself are just rattling in the house now. So at least I can do is chat to you about wrestling for a bit, and then, and hopefully get a couple of views out of it. That's the kind of hope. Yeah. Speaking of your podcast.
I was going to say in wrestling, and it needs to be emphasised greatly, there is a million and one great guys. They're some of the best people you'll ever meet. For the likes of people who are like the likes of Scott Maverick, who became a close family friend. Like, I don't have a massive circle of friends away from wrestling. I have the guys I play football with, I have the guys I go to gym with, I have the guys I do gymnastics with. I have my wee pockets in wrestling. I was always slow in doing it, because, just purely geographically. I can't be palsy if you live in Inverness, because I'll see you twice a year. It's not a can be palsy, but I'm not going to come go for a pint with you at the weekend, because it's a four-hour drive. So the people in wrestling shouldn't be vilified for being a wrestler, because of like, that whole thing I've seen. If you work for Tesco's, there's a million and one different places out there. The good guys are still there. The shows will still go on. The promotions, some will be back, some won't, some under different names, some new names, some will vanish forever. And it's up to us who are still going to be involved to carry it forward positively, and not just be the shadow of, do you remember what it used to be like? It's time to kind of shake the cobwebs off a wee bit and go, the new brand, or more the fact of the good brand should continue.
I mean, it's same with anything. It's same with anything wrestling-wise and anything in the world, really. There's always the vocal minority that ruin it for the majority that are just getting on with it, and I think I was speaking to Scotty Swift about it, and he was just like, his guys are just boring. They go set up the ring, do their show, maybe have a wee chat afterwards, and they go home. That's it. That's why there was no drama up this end, because there's no drama to be had, because they just go home. That's it.
Exactly. And most of the stuff and I'm just being careful how I say it, because I don't want Andy to feel that I'm minimising what's been said. But see, all the stories that came out and all the stuff that did come out, it didn't happen at wrestling shows. Like, it was people in their homes or at pubs and clubs and after. Like, it wasn't happening sitting at, I know there was a few dressing room things with girls down south saying that they felt uncomfortable and stuff. But again, that's down in England, and you can have that gap. But most of the stuff that was coming out wasn't happening in front of you. Like, you weren't going, oh, look at that, I'll not look at that. You know what I mean? So it's just tough to understand why everything. I think see if coronavirus never ground everything to a halt, speaking out would have done it. If that hadn't happened, if speaking out would have happened with all shows going on, everything would have ground to a halt, I think.
Definitely for some of them, I guarantee. But yeah, I mean, we're not going to labour any further about it, because if we do, we're going to just get in each other's sad. And that's not what the podcast is for.
I need a hug.
Exactly. It's not what the podcast is for. But yeah, it's a very sensitive subject. Neither of us know enough to comment on it at length, so we'll just kind of move on a little bit from it.
And I think that's important, but when these conversations are ready to be had, they are had. And being one of the, like, don't tell him they're right, but I'm one of the older guys, but the kind of more mature guys are really need to be the guys who tell these young boys coming up that, like, look what happens when you try and live like a rock star. You're not a rock star, you're a wrestler. It's professional. He'd treat it like a job, because as a job you get paid for it. So if you wouldn't date in your work, don't date in wrestling.
Exactly. I mean, if we are going to move on, but the last thing I'll say about it is if I'm in my job and I meet, I work in customer services, so if I meet a client and I do whatever I need to do, and then later on I get their number off a system and start texting them, that's inappropriate. But it's not my, it's not me doing it at work.
It's a
breach of confidence. There we go. That's the phrase we've been looking for the whole time that neither of us could think of. That's it, breach of confidence. And that's the biggest problem about it, biggest thing that's come about. Right, put that aside, that's gone. We're not speaking about that anymore. We're speaking about your podcast, because that's where we were going before we got stuck on a roundabout of speaking out. So let me decide to start your own podcast, Lucha Chat.
Yeah, I love podcasts any day of the week. Whether I'm driving, sitting in the house, sitting playing the PlayStation, I've got my headphones, and it would be whether it be like Joe Rogan, Bad Friends, Two Bears, One Cave, Your Mom's House. Oh, what's the other ones? The King and the Sting. Like, my YouTube is set up so every day there's maybe two or three podcasts in the kind of rotation. And it went through a phase when it was all wrestling lands. You'd have like Steve Austin's, Jericho's, Colt Cabana's was obviously, I still think it's the best one. Like, it was the best one that's happened. I think it's because of the longevity, and he knew what he was doing by the time everybody got on board. It was already really good. There wasn't like sound issues and cutting them off and stuff. So the wrestling ones got in a rotation, and I thought, to be fair, he did it. You don't need a lot of equipment. You need good equipment when you do use it. And then I went and done the Tuck of the Draw one with Stephen, and it was a H1 Zoom recorder on a table. And I was going, is that all it is? Like, I could get one of them. And then I was going, and I've got a different take on wrestling because I'm actually involved in it. And at first I was very much doing 30 minutes myself talking solo, but I was using it as a promotional tool. On Friday I'm here, on Saturday I'm here, buy tickets there. Because what I was trying to get away from was the blitzing of Facebook invitations to folk. Because, to be honest, that rubs people up the wrong way. But I'm not going to sit and click through 500 people. He would like one, he wouldn't. He would like one, he wouldn't. So I would just blitz everybody. And I did get heat off it from wrestlers. Like, going to, don't invite me to that promotion. Because I'm not involved in that promotion. I was like, get a grip, mate. So I'm like, so it was to get a point of having a different way of promoting. And then I kind of got a wee bug for it, and I kind of found myself having a laugh with it. And then I interviewed a couple of folk, and I kind of got good enjoyment from actually sitting and doing it. And it was a bit therapeutic. Like, I felt I was getting stuff off my chest. And there was ones where literally I'd press stop and delete, because I kind of put out what I've just said, because it's going to get me unbooked from shows, or it's going to end up me having to fight somebody at a show because somebody's going to take the hump for what I said. Because it was very much a passion piece. Like, I wasn't just going, well, on Friday you can find me here, and on, because I wouldn't listen to that, and I wanted to listen to a podcast that I would listen to. So somebody trying to have a laugh and actually get a perspective on stuff was the kind of the whole idea behind it. And then if it got me an extra booking by sending a promoter, I'll interview you on my podcast. But I never ever got to that stage of doing promoters, because I felt it was fishing.
But no, like I say, it doesn't take a lot. I've got an ancient laptop here. This cost me £2 off eBay and Zoom. That's it. That's all it takes.
I was going to do the Zoom ones, because I downloaded it, and I was going to interview Logan Smith right at the start of lockdown. And I actually have a space downstairs in my basement that I was going to convert into like a room. I was going to have people come and sit and video it, kind of Joe Rogan-ish type thing. Like, I was going to throw money at it and do it. And then, like I said, COVID slammed the brakes on, probably in a good way, because I think I would have spent a fortune on it. And it'd just be sitting down there in an empty room with my wee boy's bike in it.
I keep looking at things. I'm thinking of like getting a green screen up behind me, just so you're not seeing yellow behind me, because it's not great when you have the light straight there as well, and it's just all you can see is my head is actually starting to camouflage into the wall. It's that yellow. But I mean, to be honest, I always set this up just as a thought, and you'll be guest number 30, I think, by the time this goes out. So
that's more than I had. I think I had maybe in total 10 people interviewed.
Yeah,
and when I was interviewing them, I wasn't asking like, how did you get into it, or blah blah blah. It was more, do you remember this time? I was trying to fish the stories out. like with Krieger when I done his Harry Potter story. He told me that story in a car journey once, and in my head I went, if I ever do a podcast, that's the story I want for the podcast. And I remember telling him, he said he was going to do a podcast with somebody else. I said, don't tell that story. Let me have that story. And it's still one of my favourite stories from people in wrestling.
That's kind of what I mean. I do the boring question at starting out. I call it the boring question because I know it's the boring question of how do you get into wrestling. Because
you run a wrestling website, and if you didn't ask that question, there'll be somebody sitting at home going, "Why did you not ask that?"
Exactly.
Like it's expected of like a format like yourself to ask that type of question.
But if you're a wrestler, you can just literally go, "Oh, mind that time when." And then just go straight into
mind that time you bust my nose open. Or mind that time. In fact, the one I done with Solar, I interviewed him an hour after he'd been knocked out during my show.
I remember, yeah, because there was a disclaimer at the start of it that you literally told us that's what happened.
He is currently injured. Like I'm not even sure if he's lucid, but the two of us are sitting in his house. I've got to sit and observe him for a couple of hours because the paramedics told me to. And I had my recorder, and I said, well, let's do it. And I think it's a really good podcast for people involved in wrestling about aspects of safety.
Absolutely.
It's one of my favourites.
When they were coming out, we were putting them on the site. So if anyone wants to go check, it's under, I don't know, podcast, Luchat. You'll find them. You'll find the back catalogue, and they're on SoundCloud, so you can check them out there if anyone's watching this and wants to listen to it. After they've listened to this one, of course.
See, with yours, I'm just interested to know, because I've never done it. Do you look at the numbers? Like views, hits, sounds?
I do, because we do the 100 Club on YouTube, that really just so people share it so they can be part of this club. I'm not that worried about them. I was at first. I was like, oh, it's only 20 people listen to this one. Then my head was going, 20 people have actually listened to this. So,
but my thing with mine is, I was asked to join a network. I was actually offered a chance to earn some money with my podcast, and be on this network. And as part of it, they asked to be able to access my analytics of who thing with. And I said, no. And the guy said, why not? And I said, because I don't look at them. And he said, do you not know how many people? And I said, no, because I don't care. I do it for me. It was a passion piece. Mm-hmm. And I think he kind of liked it, because he still offered me the thing. And I said, I'm having a break just now anyway because of coronavirus. But it was one of the things that I think if you get stuck in the numbers, if you start worrying about that, you're not worrying about the quality. I think if you want the most numbers, have Gradle. You'll get the most numbers if you have Gradle.
Mm-hmm.
If you're looking for just loads of good content and keeping it interesting, you interview everybody.
Exactly. Well, that's my thought. I've got three more, and then I'm taking a break because I'll have enough podcasts from that point to take me to February next year.
Did you do Johnny Pugs? Did you do one?
Yes, he would have been interviewed by the time this comes out. So that was a really long chat. It was good fun.
Because he talks a lot of nonsense. That's fine.
That's fine. It's sometimes in this game it's about length.
He's a great guy. And as same you're talking about your giant haystacks, he's ours.
Mm.
People need to do stuff with him. He needs to be the monster on.
He was saying off the record, there's places that he wants to work, but for whatever reason they're not taking him on.
It's purely cost. He lives miles away.
Mm. Yeah, he's up in Mintlaw. So.
Yeah, but he's also a big guy. You can't just expect him to jump in a car, drive down to a shongi him. He's a big guy. He needs to be put up. He needs a room. To me, obviously, it puts the cost up and stuff. And I'm not his agent, but like we're talking about wrestling this after lockdown. Like you want to start fresh, you want new faces, and I'd have him. He'd be my first. See, if you're doing a draft, he'd be my first pick.
Mm.
I'd take him down, but you're the new monster. You're going to destroy everybody for the next 2 years and have a streak like the other. And because no dad in the crowd is going to sit in the crowd and go, I would do him. Because you wouldn't. He's a brick wall.
You have him win the big belt, and then you have the big plucky baby face just eventually by some shenanigans. Yokozuna, pretty much. Yokozuna booking. That's what you do. By shenanigans, by hook or by crook, he loses, and then it's big reaction. It's wrestling's easy. I think when you strip it back, wrestling booking is super easy. It's just a case of doing it. When you see it done right, you just look at it and go, of course it is. It's easy. Why are you making it complicated?
I remember somebody, I think it was a written interview, somebody had said to me, like, I went on Cage Match, and do you know you have now lost, like, in so many matches, or blah, 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 blah. And I was like, no, I didn't. Because chances are the mask guy doesn't lose often because he's there to lift the crowd. And when I do get beat, I normally get leathered. And in every match, I tend to get leathered. It's how wrestling works. I'm a wee guy. If I came out and started throwing Johnny Pugs about, nobody in the crowd's going to buy it. If I pick him up and slam him like Hulk Hogan did to Andre the Giant, like, that shouldn't be happening on shows. Like, maybe that once in his whole career should somebody slam him.
But yeah, just wrestling is just so straightforward and people make it so weird. Right, okay, so outside, the other venture outside of podcasts and wrestling, kind of, was just before this lockdown going out, you were advertising, was it a joint venture with Krieger?
Yeah, Powerbomb Parties. Basically, we got asked to do. I get asked all the time to do birthday parties, and I do loads. I also got asked to, during lockdown, I have done. If I said 50, I wouldn't be exaggerating. Video messages, so kids' birthdays. Would you like people message page? Can you do a wee birthday message for my son or my daughter? It's their 10th birthday. They're a fan of wrestling. Would you mind doing it? And I just say yes to everything. The plan initially was I was going to charge for them. But during lockdown, like, people are struggling. Some people are out of work and stuff. And I'm like, if I can lift somebody by doing a video, a 1 minute video, like, what's the harm? So I've done a couple of parties, done a couple of these video things. What I'd done was, at first I was doing a couple of parties, and I'd done a couple myself, and they're awful, because I'm just you're just a novelty at a party, you're a mascot, so you come in and all the kids want to touch you and pull your stuff, and I thought, see if I take somebody else from me, a bad guy, they can beat him up, or they'll just leave me alone, and I can look like a hero. So I think I'd done a couple with Saqib Ali. And the kids scanted, one of the kids scanted him, pulled his trousers in. And it was so bad at that party, the kids were wild. They were so bad, I actually had to put them behind a table and build like a table barrier around them and told them they weren't allowed to touch them anymore because they were just what I said about them. But like for that hour, I came out and I was just like, how much fun was that? And the money's good, it's easy money. If you've got a bit of personality and can keep kids amused, and obviously the mask and stuff, it works. And I do a bunch of like school things. I'll go into schools and talk about being a wrestler. I'll get in my gear, hang at the belt a couple of times. And the kids love it. And, like, just that promoting the good side of being a professional wrestler. But I always, when I do the school things, I always put it into homework. When I'm at home, I have to watch shows, I have to learn about other people and put it across. Because my last one, my boy was there, so I had to go homework, just so he would see that daddy does his homework. So from that, we got a number of party requests and TV requests and stuff. And me and Krieger were always the kind of two that were offered it. If it came through PBW, or if they contacted me, I'd just say to Krieger, because he's not too far away. And again, it's a guy away from wrestling, I want to spend time with. I've also had Dean Ford day a couple, Saqib's done a couple, Jonathan Richards, Soa, Like, it's not just me and Craig that have done them. I've kind of, if I've not been able to make it or been a show, I still try and provide something to that family who are wanting something on the day. And I thought, let's just put a name on it and get a point of contact. And when we put it up, I think on the first day we booked like 6 parties on the first day. Again, ones were here. We also, then you get a weird request. So me and Craig are during lockdown. We're meant to go to a hotel in Edinburgh with a couple of strippers and beat up a stag. And it was all arranged. We also, I think I was to beat Craig up on a TV set in front of celebrities as well for Comedy Central. It's just one of the things where we had a wee idea and it just grows arms and legs. And the stuff you're asked today is never just, can you just come in and be a wrestler? You know, there was one as well. We went and opened up a housing association event. So we went along and they basically had me and Craig like kidnap this old woman. And then they took pictures and it was in the paper. But like the pictures don't look good. It literally looks like the two of us are kidnapping this old woman. I think I've got 2 arms wrapped. I'm holding a lass and he's got legs. And I think the story beside it in the paper was something horrible as well. It was like some criminal act. And then the pictures, me and Craig are with a woman, and it just didn't fit well.
Well, speaking of TV, you did Ninja Warrior UK. Don't think you're going to get past this podcast without speaking about Ninja Warrior. How did that come about? What was your thoughts on doing that?
That came about, so Lucha Britannia in London, as a kind of big promotion, all the guys down there wearing masks, they did a whole masked event, but they're quite, I don't think I'm speaking out of school here, but they're quite closed doors, like their shows are their guys, because that's how they run their school, train their guys for their shows and then they put the shows on, but obviously the connection with Lucha and masks and all that. So they have a group, like a private group, and they let me be in it. And it was basically, I was trying to join it to get ideas for masks or making sure I wasn't doing something that somebody else is doing, like kind of basically stealing somebody's gimmick. It was kind of around about the time where I debuted and I was going in and looking at all their mask designs. I was literally clicking on every picture, making sure that I wasn't copying something that was quite standoutish that I was going to put in mine. And on it, the guy Burridge, Greg Burridge. Yeah, I think he's like one of the head guys down there. He shared the ITV clipping thing looking for people for Ninja Warrior, and I'm just like, oh, have that, tick tick tick, sent my thing away. And on the day of the audition, the audition was held in Glasgow CrossFit, and when I went in, I jumped into a wee room, and as I was there was maybe 40 people on like CrossFit gear, cycle shorts, vests, all the sports gear, and then I came out head to toe, Lucha mask, came out full garb, and the production team who were there running the auditions like kind of were right with me. They're like, oh wait, is this taking photos? And then at the end of the audition they asked me to stay behind, which I always knew was a positive. So I done some extra stuff for them, and they wanted the video me doing, because obviously I was showing off. So the wee bits that they had the obstacle course set up in the CrossFit, and I was doing flips and stuff. So at the end of it, they gave me a number, basically told me, like, don't tell them that we're going to have you. And I was like, yes. So when I turned up on the day in Manchester, they were like, yeah, you're with the wrestlers. And I was like, who's the other wrestlers? Cause, like, the best time I'd never wrestled outside of Scotland. So I was like, oh no, I'm going to be in here. I was expecting to go in there being like your household names and me just being the other guy. And when I went in, it was the Irish guys, Luther Valentine, Damien Corvin and Magico. And they'd just done a show a night before. And I was basically telling them, look, this year I've totally won this to get here. They were like, how long you been wrestling? I think it maybe 6 months or something. I'd had maybe 20 matches under my belt on shows. And they're like, oh, right. And I kind of know got that imposter feeling. Like, she's after it. And then obviously over the years I've been on shows with them now, and like we've got that wee connection where we're on that together. But I blagged my way onto it by doing flips and showing off, and I think I'd done, there was a bit where they had a rope climb set up, and instead of just running and jumping on the rope and climbing it, there was a, you know, there'd be balance things with a half rubber just to side it, so I bounced on it, somersaulted, grabbed the rope, and then they were like, oh, off on and over it. So then went down and done the show, and it was amazing. It was great. It was one of them kind of once in a lifetime memories you kind of forget.
There's not that many people that could say they were on it, so as well, it's you know, one of the few that did it in a mask. Okay, so before we wrap up then, because I think I've kept you, we're just probably closing into 2 hours now, so I think started around about 10 past 7, so hour and a half we've been chatting away, which
are you going to chop us up?
Nope. Not at all. We haven't said anything slanderous, we're all good. So, I mean, by this point, there would have been a podcast with Scottish Swift that was 2.5 hours long, so it's still not the longest. So we're fine.
let's not beat it.
Exactly. Before we go, then, is there any companies that you want to venture to that you haven't been to before once the shows begin, or you just want to just wrestle? You want to be on that first show?
I want to be on the first out in the first show. Companies, we'll see who's left after the dust settles. What I will say is I want wrestling to be fun. I want the people coming along to the show to go away with a good experience from what they see and know what happens away from it. If when a day come back, if it's not that, if it's not the vibe, don't know, like, I would never run a show. I was going to date Lance to help raise money for a charity, and it was the most stressful thing in the world. So hats off to people who do run shows. But we'll see what happens when it comes back. What companies are there? If they want me, I'll be there. I want to do more Europe stuff, over at Germany, Denmark, and just me for the experience myself. It's not about I want to be on this specific show, that specific date. I think I've got a German date. It's been pushed back a few times. I think they put it back to February of 2021. But to me, I'm under the illusion that show is going to happen. SWA, they put a thing on Facebook today saying all their dates have been pushed back. So I think it'd be a bit daft to put a name on it. That I'm not pushing for anything. I just want it to be back.
Just want to wrestle. That's just it, and just want to see if it's fun again. Same with opponents then, I assume it's the same. You just want to wrestle. You don't mind who it's against, you just want to
see as long as it's somebody that, there's nothing worse than going backstage at a show working something, like, see with somebody you don't know and they're very fixed. I do this and I do that. There's nothing merely a yawn fest, and I want to be creative. My whole thing is getting in, looking at the venues, or anything here we can use, anything here. Grabbing the referee, you want to be involved in this, you want to do something there. Let's have fun. And it's not about stealing the show as much, but I want people to go away. People will always remember the mask guy. There was this match, that match, and there was a mask guy. But I want me to be remembering my match for more than the mask. I want me to remember something they've seen, whether it be a cool move or something makes them laugh or something shocks them. And me being involved in it, then that's what you want to leave on me.
No, I don't think you could put it any better. So before we try and break the record for the longest podcast, where can people find you on social media?
Lucha DS on everything. Whatever it is. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. I think that's it. And I don't even know what other ones I've got. They're the only ones I look at, so you can hit me up on them.
And of course, go back on the Lucha podcast as well, which you can find on SWN website. So
yeah, that will come back when wrestling is back. The podcast will be back. I'll maybe have you on. You can be my first guest.
Awesome. It'll be nice to be interviewed. It'll be weird, but it'll be nice to be interviewed. But yeah, excellent. Well, thank you very much for joining me on the show.
Nobody's.
Hopefully by the time this comes out, though, we'll have a bit of a clearer idea. But like we said, I don't think we will.
I would be under the assumption that we will not go in until at least April. Just purely because the start of the financial year, the government came out today and said they're going to put furlong payments until March next year. So they already know they're not moving anything. So let's not rush it. Let's get everybody all right, make sure people stop being sick, and then we'll go out and rock the house.
Awesome. Okay, well, great. Thank you very much.
Peace, mate.